Hi everyone! So for today's lesson here in Mechanics of Deformable Bodies, we are going to discuss the fundamental concept of stress. So this will be the first part of our discussion. So for this lesson, students must be able to identify the cause of stress in the body, familiarize with the different types of stress, compute for the normal stress, internal normal force or resisting area of the body, and compute for the shear stress, internal shear force or resisting area of the body. So let's start our discussion. Okay, so mechanics of deformable bodies usually deals with stresses and deformations. So as engineers, the goal is to minimize the deformation and stress of the body in the design of machines and structures. Okay, so if you are going to define stress, no, so it describes the intensity of the internal force acting on a specific plane or area passing through a point. So it can also be defined as the strength of material per unit area or unit strength. No, so for the formula of stress, so this is just simply equal to force over area. So for the symbol or notation of stress, it depends upon the type of stress. No, now for the unit of stress, no, so since this is force over area, so in English system, no, it will be pound per inch squared. No, so that can be written, no, as PSI also, and for pound per feet squared, no, it can be written also as PSF. Okay, so in metric system, we use Pascal, and that is actually equal to Newton over meter squared. And if it's MPa or megapascal, so this is also equal to Newton over millimeter squared. Okay, and take note that 1 megapascal, that is 1,000,000 pascal. Okay, so these are the different types of stress that we are going to discuss. The first one is the normal stress. The second one is the shearing or shear stress. The third one is the bearing stress. And the last one will be the tangential and longitudinal stress in thin-walled vessels. So for this video discussion, we will discuss the first two stresses, which will be the normal stress and the shearing stress. And the remaining third and fourth stresses, no, we are going to discuss that on our next video discussion. Okay, so let's discuss the first type of stress, which is the normal stress. So normal stress, sometimes called axial stress, is a stress that measures the intensity of internal normal or axial force. So let's say we have here this body, no, so this is subjected to this force P and this force P. Okay, so if we are going to cut this body through this section, so we are going to see this section. Okay, so here in this section, there will be an internal normal force. Okay, so this will be the internal normal force. And the intensity of this internal normal force, it can be measured, no, through the normal stress. So this is the graphical representation of the normal stress. No, so this normal stress, no, or this graphical representation, no, it shows the normal stress that this body experiences, no, in this section. Okay, so the direction of this normal stress, no, it will be the same as the direction of the internal normal force. Okay, so normal stress, no, so it tends to compress or elongate a body. Okay, so if a normal stress causes the body to be compressed, no, so that normal stress is called a compressive stress. And if the normal stress causes the body to be elongated or tensioned, then that normal stress is called a tensile stress. So normal stress, this is denoted, okay, by the symbol sigma. Okay, so this is a symbol sigma, and it can be computed, no, by the formula P over A. So sigma here, again, that is the normal stress at any point on the cross-sectional area. And then P here is the internal resultant normal force which acts through the centroid of the cross-sectional area. So that P, no, it can be determined using method of sections and the equations of equilibrium. And the A here in this formula, this is the cross-sectional area of the body where the normal stress sigma is determined. Okay. So this is the summary of the procedure in computing for the normal stress. So the equation sigma is equal to P over A gives the normal stress on the cross-sectional area of a member when the section is subjected to an internal resultant normal force P. For actually loaded members, application of this equation requires the following steps. So the first step should be you have to solve the internal loading. So the internal loading here will be the internal normal force. Okay, so what you're going to do here is just section the member perpendicular to its longitudinal axis at the point where the normal stress is to be determined and use the necessary free body diagram and force equation of equilibrium to obtain the internal axial force P at that section. Okay, and then after you computed for the internal normal force, you can now compute for the normal stress. So you can compute that by determining the member's cross-sectional area at that section. Okay, and after that, you can now calculate the normal stress sigma. So that will just be equal to the internal normal force that you computed from the first step over the cross-sectional area. Okay. So let's try solving problems here for this topic. So for sample problem number one, a rod is composed of an aluminum section rigidly attached between steel and bronze sections, as shown in the figure. So axial loads are applied at the positions indicated. So if P is 3,000 pounds and the cross-sectional area of the rod is 0.5 inches squared, determine the stress in each section. So we have here this rod, So the material of this rod is steel here, and then aluminum here, and then bronze here. Okay, so this rod, so this is subjected to these applied loads. So the applied loads here are for P, and we have P here. Okay, so the value of P is 3,000 pounds. Okay, and then this is attached here. So this is fixed here, in this support. Okay, so what we're going to do here is determine the stress in each section. So we are going to determine the stress in the steel section. We're going to determine the stress in the aluminum section. And we are going to determine the stress in the bronze section. Okay, so let's start solving this. So again, what we're going to solve here in this problem will be the stress in each section. So we are going to follow the procedure in solving for the normal stress. So the first step will be to solve first the internal loadings. So let's say for the steel section, okay, so to solve for the internal normal force of the steel section, we will cut this rod through this section. Okay, so drawing the free body diagram of the of that cut section, so that will be this free body diagram. So we are going to solve the internal normal force here. So the internal normal force here will be denoted by this force F. Okay, so to solve for this force F, we are going to use equilibrium equation. So this will just be summation of forces horizontal is equal to zero. So this will just be F minus 4P equal to zero. Okay, so solving for F, so P is just 3,000, so it is given in the problem. So solving for F, this will just be 12,000 pounds. Okay, so this will now be the internal normal force in the steel section. Okay, so now we can solve for the normal stress in the steel section. So that will just be sigma is equal to F over A. Okay, where in F here is the internal normal force that we computed, which is 12,000. And the area here will be the cross-sectional area, which is given in the problem. And that is 0.5 inches squared. Now, so we can now solve for the normal stress sigma. So that will just be 12,000 divided by 0.5. And that will be 24,000. So the unit here is pound per inches squared. So we can just rewrite this as PSI. Okay, so this will now be the normal stress in the steel section. So we can now box this answer. No, so now we will proceed to the aluminum section. So we are going to solve for the normal stress also that the aluminum section experiences. No, so in order for us to do that, now, we have to solve first for the internal loading for the aluminum. So, we are going to solve that by cutting this rod, no, through this section. Okay, so this will be the free body diagram of that cut section. And here in this cut section, no, there will be an internal normal force. So, we will denote that as F. Okay, so solving for this internal normal force F, now we will use equilibrium equation. So we can use summation of forces horizontal. So for summation of forces horizontal, that will just be F minus 4P. So it will just be the same, right? So P, again, that is given in the problem and that is 3,000 pounds. So solving for F, so this will just be 12,000 pounds also. Okay, so solving for the normal stress that the aluminum section experiences, so that will just be sigma is equal to F over A. So the internal normal force F will be 12,000 pounds over 0.5 inches squared. So again, the normal stress that the aluminum section experiences is the same as the normal stress that the steel section experiences. So this is also 24,000 PSI. So we can already box this since we are really solving this now in the problem. So this is the answer now for the normal stress for the aluminum section. Okay, so we will now proceed now to the bronze section. So we are going to solve its normal stress. So again, we are going to cut now this rod through this section here, no, to solve for the internal loading of the bronze. So actually we have two options here, no, so we can either use the section or the segment here at the left or the segment here at the right. But if you are going to use the segment here at the right, we have to solve first for the reaction here at the support. So we are going to use instead the left segment. Also let's say here in this steel section, we can also use we can also use this right segment, but the problem is that we have to solve first for the reaction here at the support. Same here with the aluminum section. So instead of using this left segment, we can also use the right segment, no, but again, the problem is that we have to solve first for the reaction here at the support, no. So that will be the same for bronze, huh? But here we are going to use the left segment, no, so that it will just be easier, no, to solve. Okay, so for the internal loading of the bronze section, so this will be the free body diagram of the bronze section. Okay, so we cut the rod here, huh, through this section. Okay, so here in this cut section, there will be an internal normal force and that will be denoted as F. Okay, so to solve for this F, okay, we can use equilibrium equation. So we can use summation of forces horizontal and that will be equal to zero. So this will just be F minus 4P. Okay, so plus we also have P here. Okay, so P is given and that is 3,000 pound, no, so substituting P here, so that will just be F minus 3 times 3,000 is equal to 0. Solving for F, that will be 9,000 pound. So this is the internal normal force that this bronze, no, experiences. Okay, so we will solve for the normal stress, so that will just be sigma is equal to F over A. So sigma will just be equal to 9,000 pound over 0.5 inches squared. So 9,000 divided by 0.5, so that will just be 18,000. No, so the unit for this will be PSI. Okay, so this will now be the normal stress that the bronze section, okay, experiences. So you can already box this. No, so this will now be the answers, no, for this problem. We already solved for the normal stress in the steel section, for the aluminum section, and for the bronze section. So let's proceed now to sample problem number 2. The 80 kilogram lamp is supported by two rods AB and BC as shown in the figure. If AB has a diameter of 10 mm and BC has a diameter of 8 mm, determine the average normal stress in each rod. No, so we are going to determine the average normal stress. So this is just the same with normal stress. Okay, so we are going to solve for the normal stress in rod AB and rad BC. Okay, so in order for us to do that, we have to solve first for the internal loadings, no, of AB and BC. Okay, so take note that this lamp, no, has a mass of 80 kilogram. No, so we have to convert first, no, this 80 kilogram, no, into weight. No, so weight will just be mass times the acceleration due to gravity, no? So that will just be 80 times 9.81 meter per second squared to solve for the weight, no, of this lamp. So let us solve this problem. Okay, so to solve for the normal stress in each rod, again, we have to solve first, no, for the internal loading of each rod. Okay, so this will be the free body diagram of this force system. Okay, so rad AB, no, so this will be represented by this force BA, no, and this rad BC, no, so this will be represented by this FBC. Okay, so the weight of the lamp will just be equal to 80 kilogram times 9.81, and that will be equal to 784.8 newton. So we will solve the internal loadings, no, by using equations of equilibrium here. So as you learn in statics of rigid body, so this is a concurrent force system, so we can solve this. Now we have two unknowns here, FBC and FBA, so we can solve them by using two equations. So that will be summation of forces horizontal and one summation of forces vertical. Okay, so for the summation of forces horizontal, that will be equal to zero. Okay, so this will just be the summation of all the horizontal forces, ha? Okay, so the horizontal component of FBC will just be FBC times 4 over 5 minus, no, so this will be the horizontal component of FBA, so that will be FBA cosine 60 degrees, okay, and this will be equal to 0. So this will serve as our equation 1. Now for the second equation, we can generate that by using summation of forces vertical, and that will be equal to 0. So our assumption here is positive for forces that are directed upward. So for the vertical component of FBC, that will just be FBC times 3 over 5. So that will be positive, ha, since it is directed upward. Plus the vertical component of FBA, so that will be FBA sine 60 degrees. So this is also positive since FBA is directed upward. And then we have here negative 784.8 since this is directed downward. Okay. So this will be equal to 0, and this will be our equation 2. Okay, so for this two unknowns, no, so we can solve this since we have two equations here. Okay, so solving for these two equations, so you can solve this either by elimination or by substitution. Okay, so if you are going to use substitution, no, so you can solve for FBC, no, using equation 1 in terms of FBA, and then substitute that here in the FBC here, so that the only unknown will be FBA. Okay, so solving that, no, so we can solve for FBA and FBC. So FBA will just be equal to 632.38 newton. Okay, and then after that, we can solve for FBC. So that will just be equal to 395.24 newton. Okay, so this will now be the internal forces, no, that we are looking for, no, to solve for the normal stress in each rod. Okay, so to solve for the normal stress, no, for the rod BC, okay, so the cross-sectional area, no, of these rods, no, are given, so we can now solve for the normal stress. So for the normal stress here at rod BC, so that will just be equal to the internal force here at BC, no, and or internal normal force, and then divided by the area, okay. So, this will just be equal to the FBC that we solve, which is 395.24 newton over the area. So, here the given, no, in the problem is the diameter. So, if the given is diameter, meaning to say the cross-sectional area is a circle. No, so the area of a circle, so the formula will be pi over 4 diameter squared, right? Or it can also be pi r squared, or r there will be the radius, no? So here the given is diameter, so we can solve for the area by using the formula pi over 4 d squared, no? So the diameter, no, for rod BC is 8 millimeter, no? So that's the given. Okay, so this will be pi over 4 times 8 squared. Okay, so that will be the area for rod BC. So solving this, so we can input this in our calculator, 395.24 over the area of the cross-sectional area, no, of rod BC, and that is pi over 4 times 8 millimeter squared. So this will be 7.86 newton per millimeter squared, no? So take note that newton per millimeter squared, that is also MPa, ha? So this will now be the answer for the normal stress in rod BC. Now for the normal stress in rod AB, no, so that will be sigma BA is equal to the internal normal force at rod BA over the cross-sectional area. So for the internal normal force here in rod AB, so that will just be 632.38 newton. And for the area, or the cross-sectional area, so for rod AB, the given is a diameter, no, of 10 millimeters. So again, the cross-sectional area here will be circle, no? So it's supposed to be a circle, no? So the formula for the area of a circle is pi over 4 diameter squared. Okay, so again, that will just be pi over 4 10 squared, no? So solving for the normal stress in the rod BA, no, so that will just be 632.38 over pi over 4 10 millimeter squared. So this will be 8.05 newton per millimeter squared, or MPa. So this will now be the answers. So for sample problem number 3, member AC shown in the figure is subjected to a vertical force of 3 kilonewton. Determine the position x of this force so that the average compressive stress at the smooth support C is equal to the average tensile stress in the tie rod AB. So the rod has a cross-sectional area of 400 millimeters squared, and the contact area at C is 650 millimeters squared. Okay, so this member AC, okay, so again, this is supported, no, by this rod here at A, and this is supported, no, here at C. So this is just leaning here at C. So this is just a no, this is just a smooth surface support. No, so we are going to solve for this position x. Okay, so we can solve this, no, and we have here this given, no, that the average compressive stress, okay, at the smooth support C, so smooth support C here, no, it will be subjected to a compressive stress, right? So it will be compressed, and then here at the rad AB, no, so this will be subjected to a tensile stress. So we are going to use that equation, that the compressive stress, no, here at smooth support C, that will be equal to the average tensile stress of rad AB. Okay, so let's solve this problem. Okay, so to solve for this position X, okay, so we have to solve first for the internal loadings, no, here at rad AB and the smooth support here at C. Okay, so in order for us to solve that, now we are going to draw the free body diagram of member AC. Okay, so this will be the member AC, and here it is supported by a rad AB, so there will be a tension here. Okay, so this normal force, no, it will be denoted by FAB. Okay, and also here, since this is just a smooth surface, no, so there will just be a normal force here, and it is denoted by F sub C. Okay, now we can solve this, no, the unknowns here, by using equilibrium equation. But as you can see here, there are three unknowns, right? So the unknowns will be FAB, X is also unknown, and FC. So there will be three unknowns. But here, since this is a parallel force system, okay, as you've learned in your statics of rigid bodies, if it's a parallel force system, we can only generate two equilibrium equations, right? So that will be one summation of forces, no, either horizontal or vertical, is equal to zero, and one summation of moment, also equal to zero. So since there will be three unknowns, no, so we will need to generate another equation. So that third equation, no, we can generate that with the given, no, in the problem. Okay, so the given in the problem is the compressive stress at the smooth support C, that is equal to the tensile stress, no, in the tie rod AB. Okay, so we are going to use that equation, that the compressive stress is equal to the tensile stress, no? So we will use that as the third equation to solve for the three unknowns. So for the first equilibrium equation, so we will use summation of forces vertical here, since the forces here are vertical, okay, and that will be equal to zero. So our assumption is positive for upward forces. So this will just be FAB plus FC minus 3 is equal to 0. So this will serve as our equation 1. And for the second equilibrium equation, we will take moment here at point A. So that will be equal to 0. And our assumption here will be clockwise for positive rotation. So FAB will be cancelled since it passes through point A. And then for FC, no, so its moment will be this first, no, so for the force 3 kilonewton, okay, so its moment about point A will be 3 times its moment arm, which is x, okay, so that will be 3x, and its rotation will be clockwise, so it will be positive here. Now for FC, so its moment about point A will be FC times 200 millimeter, okay, and its rotation will be counterclockwise, so it will be negative here. So this will be equal to zero, and this will be our second equation. Now for the third equation, again, we are going to use the given that the compressive stress at the smooth support C, which is denoted as sigma sub C, so that will be also equal, no, so this will be equal, no, to the tensile stress at rad AB. So it will be denoted by sigma sub T. And take note that compressive and tensile stress, they are just normal stresses, huh? So it will have the same formula. So the formula for compressive stress will be compressive force, no, that we have in the smooth surface C. So that will be FC, okay, over the area. Okay, at that will be the ano no the area of contact which is given in the problem. And then for the tensile stress, so that will just be the tensile force that the rod AB experiences over the cross-sectional area of rod AB, which is also given in the problem. So substituting the areas mentioned in the problem. So for the area of the contact surface, so that will be 650 millimeter squared, no? And for the area of the rod AB, so that is given in the problem, that is 400 millimeter squared as well, no? So we can express FC, no, in terms of FAB. Okay, so FC will just be equal to 650 over 400. So we just cross multiply. Okay, so that will be 650 divided by 400. That is actually equal to 1.625. No, so FC is equal to 1.625 FAB. So to solve this, no, the unknowns, we are going to substitute this FC, no, to equation 1. If you're going to substitute FC to equation 1, so this will be this FC will be expressed, no, in FAB. So the only unknown here will be FAB. So we can solve for FAB, and that will be 1.14386 kilonewton. Okay, so this will be the value of FAB, and after we solve FAB, now we can now solve for FC, no, using this equation. We just substitute this FAB here. So solving for FC, that will just be 1.85877 kilo newton. Now, since we already have FC, we can use this, no, in equation 2 to solve for the value of X. So the position X, no, we can determine that, no, and the value for that will be 123.92 millimeters. Okay, so this will now be the answer for this problem, no? So the position X should be 123.92 millimeter, no? So that the compressive stress at the smooth support C, no, will be equal to the tensile stress in the tie rod AB. Okay, so this is actually logical naman, since this position X, this is less than 200 millimeter, right? So if your answer here exceeds 200 millimeter, no, so that will not be logical. Okay, so so the answer for this will be, again, this is 123.92 millimeter. So you can already. Okay, so let's talk about now the second type of stress, which is the shear stress or shearing stress. So shear stress, it is a stress that measures the intensity of internal shear force. Okay, so it tends to cut, divide, or tear the body. Now, so let's say we have here this system of bodies. Okay, and assume that this body, no, originally is just one body. No, and if we are going to apply a force F here, no, so the tendency will be this body will be cut, no, in this section, no, so it will cut or it will tear right in this section here and in this section here. And since it will be pressed downward, no, by applying this force F, so the tendency will be this block, no, it will slide down, right? And that sliding actually causes a shear stress. Okay, so upon drawing the free body diagram, okay, of the block that will slide down, okay, so this will be that free body diagram. Okay, so if you are going to apply force F here, no, so of course there will be resisting forces here, so it will be resisted by this force here and the force on the other side. Okay, so these forces are actually the shear force, no? So this shear force, okay, it can be or its intensity, it can be measured, no, by its shearing stress. And the shearing stress, it can be graphically represented by this representation. Okay, so this part of this body, no, this section, this is experiencing this stress. And also on the other side, no, there will be an experience stress, no, and this stress or this shearing stress, its direction is also the same as the direction of the shear force. Okay, so this shear stress, okay, so this is coplanar with the cross section of the material. So the shearing area for this shear stress, no, will be this area, and also the area on the other side. Okay, so shearing stress, it differs to tensile and compressive stresses, which are caused by forces perpendicular to the area on which they act. So shearing stress is actually also known as tangential stress. Okay, so shearing stress is actually denoted by the symbol tau. Okay, so this is tau, and it can be computed by this formula. So this will be V over A, where in V here is the shear force. Okay, so this is the internal shear force, and the area will be the shearing area or the cross section, okay, of the area. So again, the tau here, this is the average shear stress or the shear stress at that section. And then V is the internal resultant shear force on the section determined from the equations of equilibrium. So in this case, if you are going to solve for the shear force V here, okay, so we can use equilibrium equation here. We can just sum up forces here, okay, to solve for V. Okay, now for A, so that will be the area at the section where we are solving the shearing stress. So to easily determine, no, the area or the shearing area, no, so analyze the body, no, upon application of a force, no, where will the body where will it tear, okay, where will it be cut, okay? So in this case, if you are going to push this body, no, upon applying this force F, no, we know that it will be cut here and here, right? So the cross section of that cut area will be this area, and this will be the shearing area. Okay, also, just to make it clear to you, let's say we have here this bolt, okay, and we have here this plate, no, so this is place here, no, this plate, and this is subjected to this force F, and also this plate, no, this is also subjected to force F. Okay, so in the whole of the plates, there will be a bolt, and if you are going to push this plate, no, towards this direction, and also this plate towards this direction, so this bolt or pin, okay, it will be stressed, right? So if you're going to analyze, no, if it will be pushed towards this direction and it will be pushed towards this direction, no, where do you think will the tearing happen in the pin? Okay, so the tearing will actually happen here, no, in between the plates, right? It will happen here. This bolt, no, will tear here in this part, right, in this section. So if we are going to draw the free body diagram of that section, no, so this will be that free body diagram, okay, and here, no, so this will be the section where the bolt will be cut or will tear, no, and there will be a shearing force here, and the shear force here will be this force P. Okay, so in order to solve for the shear stress, no, in this section of the pin or bolt, no, we will just use the formula V over A, and then the area will be just the cross section, okay, of the bolt. Okay, okay. Now, we also have this so-called double shear. So, a double shear, this is an instance where a single material develops simultaneous shear stresses into separate parallel resisting area. So in this case, no, this is actually double shear, since upon application of force F, no, there will be two shear developed here. Okay, this shear force V and this shear force B. So it will be a double shear. Okay, so if we are going to solve for this shear force V naught, yun nga, we are going to use equilibrium equation. So if you are going to use summation of forces here, it will just be 2V minus F is equal to 0, right? So meaning to say the shear force, no, it will just be 1/2 of the force F, applied force F. Okay, so this case is ano ha, this is a double shear. While this case, no, since there will only be a single shear here, no, a single shear force here, or there will be only one shearing area here, no, it is just a single shear, no, this case. Meanwhile, in this case, okay, if you are going to push this plate towards this direction and push this plate towards this direction, so again, this bolt or pin will be stressed, no? And where do you think will the tearing happen, no? So it will happen here, no, in between here and in between here. So this case is also actually this is also a double shear. This will also experience, this pin will experience double shear because it will tear here in this part, no, and in this part, in between these plates, right? So this is also a double shear. Okay, so let's try solving problems for this topic. Okay, so this will be the procedure first, no, for solving shearing stress. So the application of shearing stress tau is equal to V over A is used to determine the shear stress in the material. So application requires the following steps. So the first one is you have to solve first for the internal shear force. No, so to solve for the internal shear force, section, no, the member at the point where the average shear stress is to be determined. No, and then draw the necessary free body diagram and calculate the internal shear force V acting at the section that is necessary to hold the part in equilibrium. And then after you solve for the internal shear force, we can now solve the shear stress. So to solve for shear stress, if the section area is not given, so you have to determine that. And then after you determine the area where the shearing stress happens, no, so we can now determine the shear stress. So that will just be equal to V over A. Okay, so for sample problem number one, determine the average shear stress in the 20 millimeter diameter pin at A and the 30 millimeter diameter pin at B that support the beam in figure A. So this beam AB, okay, so this is the beam AB. This is supported by a pin here at A, no, and it is also supported by a rod, no, by a rod here at point B, no. So this rod, no, so this is supported by a pin. Okay, so there is a pin here, no. So here at point A, no, here at support A, so this is the top view, no, in this part. So this is the top view. So this beam, okay, so this is supported by this pin this way. Okay, and also here, if you're going to look at the top view, so this rod BC, so this is supported, no, by connected, no, to this beam, no, by this pin. Okay, so this is supported this way, no, here at support at B. Now, the pins here, let's say for a pin at A, so this is the pin at A, so this will experience a shear stress, no? And since there will be two areas, no, that where tearing will happen here, no, so this pin will experience double shear, right? So as you can see here, this pin, it can the tendency, it will tear here at this part, no? And it will also tear, no, at this part, right? So this will experience double shear, okay? While here in the support at B, okay, so the pin here, the shear stress that it will experience will only be a single shear since there will be a single area here that will have the tendency to tear, right? So here, this pin, No, so this pin, it will tear here at this area, right? In between this, in between the contact of this rod, okay, and this support, right? So it will tear here. So this will experience a single shear only. So we will determine the shear stress in each pin. Okay, so the given diameter for pin at A is 20 millimeter, and the diameter of the pin here at B is 30 millimeter. So let's try solving this problem. So for us to solve the shear stress in pin at A and pin at B, we have to determine first the internal loadings. So to determine the internal loadings, we have to solve the reaction, okay, that will happen here at point A and here at point B. Okay, so drawing the free body diagram of beam AB, so it is supported by a pin here at A, so it will have one vertical reaction and one horizontal reaction. Okay, and here at point B, so this will be supported by this rod, and the rod and the beam is connected by a pin, ha? But the reaction force that this rod BC will provide, it will be denoted by this by this force. So this is FB, and its slope will be 4. The rise is 4 and the run is 3. So the hypotenuse of the slope triangle is 5. Okay. Anyway, so we are going to solve this unknown forces or reaction forces by using equilibrium equations. So here, this is a non-concurrent force system, right? There will be three unknowns, FB, AX, and AY. So we can answer this because we can generate three equations since this is a non-concurrent force system. So we can use summation of forces horizontal is equal to zero, summation of forces vertical is equal to zero, and one summation of moment. Okay, so let's first generate the first equation, using summation of moment at A. So we will take moment here at A is equal to zero. Okay, so we will assume clockwise rotation as positive. So here, we can directly solve for FB since AX and AY will be canceled since it will pass through point A, right? So taking up the moment here at point A, it will be this FB, so the vertical component of FB, that will be the only component that will have a moment about point A, because its horizontal component, it will pass through point A, so it will just be cancelled, so the vertical component of force FB will be FB times 4 over 5, and then its moment will be its rotation will be counterclockwise, right? So it will be negative here times the moment arm. So the moment arm here will be 4 plus 2, and that will be 6. Okay, and then this 30 kilonewton force, it will also have a moment about point A. So its moment about point A will be 30 times its moment arm, which is 2. And then its rotation will be clockwise, so it will be positive here. So this will be equal to zero. So we can directly solve for FB here. So FB, it will just be, we can just transpose that on the other side. So that will be 30 times 2 over 4 over 5 times 6, right? So the answer for this will be 12.5 kilonewton. So this will be FB, the value of FB. Okay, so we can also solve for AX and AY. So we can generate another equilibrium equation here. So we will use summation of forces horizontal is equal to zero to solve for AX. Okay, so summing up forces horizontal, so the horizontal component of FB will be 12.5. So the value of FB is already 12.5 times 3 over 5. So this will be the horizontal component. And then this is positive since this is directed to the right. And then for our AX, so this will be negative since this is directed to the left. And this will be equated to 0. So we can directly solve for AX. So AX will just be equal to 12.5 times 3 over 5. And that is 7.5 kilonewton. Okay, to solve for AY, we can use summation of forces vertical is equal to 0, assuming upward forces as positive. So this will just be AY. The vertical component of FB will be FB times 4 over 5, and the value of FB is already 12.5 from here. And then this 30 kilonewton force, since this is downward, it will be negative here. So this will be equated to 0, and we can directly solve for AY. So solving for AY, so this will just be equal to negative 12.5. Since we are going to transpose that, no, so it will become negative. Negative 12.5 times 4 over 5 plus, so that this negative 30 will become positive if we are going to transpose that on the other side. So it will become plus 30. So the answer for this is 20 kilonewton. So this will now be the value of AY, AX, and FB. Now, we are going to solve for the resultant reaction, no, here at A. We are going to use that, no, in solving for the shear stress at pin A or the shear force at pin A. Okay, so the resultant reaction here at point A will be just equal to the square root of AX squared plus AY squared. So that will just be square root of 7.50 squared plus 20 squared. So the resultant reaction here at point A will be 21.36 kilonewton. Now, if we are going to draw the free body diagram, okay, here at the pin at A, okay, so this will be the pin, right? So this is the pin, okay, is connected to this leaves, no, this way. So if we are going to draw the free body diagram of this pin, so it will have this. So if we are going to transfer this this reaction force at A, no, it will be transferred here at the pin this way. So it will be it will have the opposite direction, right? So the reaction force here at pin A, no, it will be 21.36 kilonewton. So if this pin will experience this force, no, it will be this force is directed this way, right? So this pin, it will be stressed, right? And this pin, it will tear, no, here at this part and here at this part, right? So it will experience double shear, right? So this force or reaction FA, which is 21.36 kilonewton, it will be distributed by the two shear force VA here and VA here. Okay, so using equilibrium equation here, so to solve for the shear force VA, it will just be FA minus 2VA is equal to 0, right? So that will be the equilibrium equation. And to solve for VA, that will just be FA over 2, right? So solving for VA, it will just be 21.36 over 2. Therefore, the shear force that will happen here, or this spin will experience, will be 10.68 kilonewton. Okay, so we will use this shear force VA in solving for the shear stress in pin at A, okay, in this pin, okay. So, okay, let's proceed. Okay, so here at the pin, here at point B, okay, so again, no, this rod or cable, no, so this is connected with the beam through this pin, okay, so since this cable, no, or rod, this has a reaction force, no, and its reaction force is FB, right? We already solved that in the previous slide. So we are going to transfer, no, the reaction, okay, of this here in this cable BC, no, we are going to transfer that here in the pin. No, so transferring that force here, so it will be FB is equal to 12.5, and it will be directed oppositely. No, so if the reaction here at cable BC is directed this way, no, in our solution, so it will be transferred to the pin, and it will be transferred this way. So this is directed oppositely, no. So if this pin, no, will be subjected to this force FB, no, it will experience a shear stress. Okay, so this pin, no, it will tear, no, in between the connection, no, in between this rod or cable and this beam, right? So in between it will tear, no, it will tear here, no, this way, this pin, no, will tear this way here, so it will experience a single shear. And in this area where it will tear, okay, so there will be a shear force, and this shear force is denoted as V B, no. And then if you are going to solve for VB, no, using equilibrium equation, we can solve that VB, no, it will just be equal, no, to FB, right? So VB is equal to FB, and that is just equal to 12.5 kilonewton. Now we already have the shear force for pin at A and pin at B. We can now solve for the shear stress. Okay, so for the shear stress in the pin at A, so we already solved for VA, and the A here, no, in this problem, no, the given is the diameter, no. So basically, the area of that pin, no, is a circle, no, and the area for circle, that is pi over 4 diameter squared. No, so in this case, we can now solve for the shear stress or tau at pin A, and that will be equal to 10.68. So this is the shear force that we solved from the previous slide, and then over pi over 4 times the diameter. The given diameter is 20 millimeter, so this will be 20 squared here. And then here, if we're going to input that in our calculator, 10.68 over pi over 4 times 20 squared, so that is actually equal to 0.033995. And the unit here, take note, for 10.68, this is kilonewton, and for this diameter, this is millimeter, right? So this will be kilonewton over millimeter squared. No, so just to make this unit standard, no, we can make it 33.995 newton, no? So instead of kilonewton, we can make it newton. So this will be become 33.995 newton over millimeter squared. And take note that newton over millimeter squared, that is also MPa, right? So this will now be the shear stress, okay, at pin at A, okay? Again, this is 33.995 megapascal. Okay, now for the shear stress at pin at B, no? Okay, so it will just be tau B is equal to the shear force at the shearing area over the shearing area. So the VB that we solve here is 12.5 kilonewton, so this will be 12.5 over the area. So this is the shearing area, so this will just be the cross section of the pin at B. And the given here is a diameter, right? So again, the area for a circle is pi over 4 diameter squared, so this will just be pi over 4 30 squared. And then inputting this in our calculator, this will be 12.5 over pi over 4 30 squared. So this will be 0.017684 kilonewton over millimeter squared. So we can rewrite this as 17.684 newton over millimeter squared, or MPa, or megapascal. So this will now be the shear stress in pin at B. So this will now be the answers for this problem. So for sample problem number 2, What force is required to punch a 20 mm diameter hole in a plate that is 25 mm thick? So the shear strength here is 300 meganewton over meter squared. Okay, so let's say we have here this puncher, and if you're going to apply this force P, no, so this puncher, no, can punch this out. Okay, it can punch this out. This section can be punched out, no, from this plate. No, so we are going to determine this required P, no, in order to punch this section, no, from this 25 millimeter thick plate. Okay, so let's analyze and solve this problem. Okay, so to solve for the force required, no, take note that the magnitude of the shear force, no, required to punch this section or this area, no, it will be equivalent to the force P. Okay, so the shear force will act at the shearing area. So as you can see here, no, this punch out will slide right from the plate. Okay, so there will be a shear stress here, and the shear stress will happen, no, at the area where it was torn, no. So it will be torn, no. It will be torn in this ano, no, in this area, right? So this this area, okay. So this area, the surroundings, no, of this punch out, this one with the lighter lighter hatch here, okay. So this will be the area, right, where it will tear, no, this plate will tear, right? So that will be the shearing area, and in this shearing area there will be a developed shear stress here. And take note again, no, the shear force will act at the shearing area. Okay, so, and that will just be equal to the force P also. Okay, so for the shear stress, no, there is a given shear strength here, and take note that a stress, no, this is also defined as the strength, right, of the material, no, over on a specific area, right? Okay, so what will happen here is we're going to use the shear strength, no, as the shear stress, since they will be equal. Okay, so the shear strength, which is the given, is 350, no, actually the given is okay, so the given shear strength is actually 350 meganewton, okay, over meter squared. But meganewton over meter squared, that is actually megapascal, right? And we know that megapascal, that is also equal to newton over millimeter squared. So this will just be 350 newton per millimeter squared. So this will be equal to the V, or the shear force, which will be equal to force P also. So this will just be P over A. So the A here will be the area, no, where the plate will tear, no. So it was torn, no, in this ano, no, in this area. So the area of this one, okay, it will be the what do you call this, the circumference of the circle. So that is actually pi d, right? So that's the circumference of the circle times the thickness. So the thickness is 25 millimeters to solve for this area, ha? So the area that we are considering here, again, this is not this cross section, ha, not the area of this circle, but the area, the surface area here. Okay, so this is the area that surrounds this, right? So that will just be the circumference of the circle. So that will be pi times the diameter, which is 20, and then the thickness, which is 25 millimeter. So that's where the shearing stress will happen, right? So here we can now solve for the force P. So we can directly solve for the force P. So that will just be, so class here, ha, you have to be consistent with the unit. So since we use millimeter here in this side, so of course we have to be consistent that the dimensions here will also be millimeter, right? So solving for P here, that will just be 350 times pi times 20 times 25. So that will just be 175,000 pi, or 549,778 Newton. Okay, so the unit here will be Newton, right? Since this is Newton here. And we can rewrite this as kilonewton. So this will just become 549.778 kilonewton. So this will now be the answer for this problem. So this is the required force. Okay, required force P, okay, that will cause for this area, no, to be punched out, no, from this plate. Okay, so this will now be the answer. So let's proceed now to sample problem number 3. If the wood joint in the figure has a width of 150 millimeter, determine the shear stress develop along shear planes AA and AB. So these are the shear planes AA and BB. Okay, so we are going to solve for the shear stress develop along these shear planes. Now, as we can see here, if this body, no, so this is a wood joint, no. Okay, so this wood. Okay, if it is pushed towards this direction, okay, so it will have a reaction force here, no, at the contact here and at the contact here, right? So we are going to solve that, no, and we are going to draw the free body diagram also of this shear plane AA. We are going to solve for this because there will be a developed shear stress here in this section, and also here. No, we will draw the free body diagram here at this section here, no, because there will be a developed shear stress also here. Okay, so let's start solving this. Okay, so to solve for the shear stress developed along shear planes AA and BB, we have to solve first for the internal loading. So to solve for the internal loadings in these sections, now we have to solve first the force here. Now that will be developed here, or that will this smooth support or smooth surface will provide here and also here. No, so we are going to draw the free body diagram of this body. No, so upon application of 6 kilonewton force here, of course it will be resisted. No, by these two forces. No, so the force here at this smooth surface and here at this smooth surface. So it will be denoted by force F and force F. So it will just be equal. No, and we will use equilibrium equation here, not to solve for force F here and force F here. So applying summation of forces horizontal, assuming forces directed to the right as positive, no, so it will just be 6, that will be positive since it is directed to the right, so, and then minus F, and then minus F, since they are both directed to the left, no, and this will be equal to 0. So this will just be 6 minus 2F, and solving for F, so that will just be 3 kilonewton. So this force F is 3 kilonewton, this force F is also 3 kilonewton. Okay, now, to solve for the shear stress in plane AA, okay, so we are going to draw the free body diagram of that. No, so the free body diagram of a plane AA will be this one. So here at this cut section, no, there will be a shear force. Okay, so the force F here, no, it will be reflected here, of course. So that is already 3 kilonewton, no, from our computation. So the shear force here, it can be solved, no, by using equilibrium equation. So that will just be summation of forces horizontal is equal to 0. So this will just be VA minus 3 is equal to 0, and VA will just be 3 kilonewton. Okay, so the shear force here at section AA is just 3 kilonewton. Now, also for plane BB, okay, we can draw its free body diagram. So this will be its free body diagram. And take note that this force F here, no, if you're going to transfer that here, no, it will be directed oppositely. Okay, so the shear force, it will be directed this way. No, so we can solve for that shear force VB, no, by using equilibrium equation, summation of forces horizontal is equal to 0, and that will just be negative VB plus 3 is equal to 0. So solving for VB, that will just be 3 kilonewton as well. Okay, so we can now solve for the shear stress since we already solved for the internal shear force here at plane AA and the shear force here at plane VB. So, solving for the shear stress for the plane AA, so let's say this is tau A is equal to VA over AA. So, here, the shear force will be 3 kilonewton. And then the shearing area here will be the area at this section. So this is 0.1, right? So this is 0.1 meter. And in the problem, it is mentioned that the width, no? So the width of this, no? The width here is 0.15 meter, no? So the area of the of this section here will just be 0.10 times 0.15. Okay, so solving for the shear stress here at plane AA, so this will just be 3 over 0.10 times 0.15. So this will be 200. And the unit here is kilonewton over meter squared, and kilonewton per meter squared, that is actually kilopascal. So this will now be the shear stress developed along shear plane AA. Now for the shear stress in plane BB, so this will be tau B is equal to VB over AB, and the shear force here is 3 kilonewton over the area. So the area here, so this dimension is 0.125 meter, and the width, as mentioned in the problem, is 0.15 meter. So solving for the shear stress not developed along shear plane BB, that will just be 3 over 0.125 times 0.15. So that will be 160 kilonewton over meter squared. So that will be 160 kilopascal. So this will now be the answers, no, for this problem. So that concludes our discussion for this topic. I hope that you learn and attain the learning outcomes. So don't forget that you have CM assessment tasks that you have to answer and submit on our next meeting. So the problems for that assessment task is located in the latter pages of the course material for this topic. So also see to it that you subscribe to this channel and please like and share this video. So also class, for bonus points, I will be giving bonus points for the first 3 students who will comment the concept that they learn from this topic. So it can be a single sentence or 2. Okay, so again, the first 3 students who will be able to watch the entire video, okay, and comment the concept that they learn in the comment section will receive the bonus points. Okay, so God bless you, class, and see you again soon. Bye-bye.